Now then, this poor thing needs a bit of TLC. My summer beater of the last few years, and I've never given it any cosmetic attention, almost as a deliberate policy, because I primp and preen too much on the other ones, I know I do. And so I had one bike that I deliberately didn't touch and just let it weather, and it's lived outside. So I think though now is the time before I make it this summer beater to give it some attention. One of the reasons being that some of these rust spots on here are open to the elements and in danger of actually corroding through. Can you see some oil, like iridescence, as though there's oil there? That's actually where there's been a fracture in the paint, too small for us to see really, and weather's got underneath it, so that needs attending to. I'm thinking if I can do some kind of scuff pad material there, but if I put something self-adhesive on, is that not just acting as a water trap? So I shall see what to do there, maybe just to sand down and see what I've got when I sand it down. There's been some bad touching up here, and it had a big gash when I got it, so I just slapped some mismatched brown on. I'm just going to sand that back, smooth it a bit. All of the paint I'm going to give a cut back with 1500 wet and dry, wet sanding, just to take all this top layer of environmental crud off it, and degraded paint, and get back down to good paint. And that's an old sticker on there, so I've got some brake cleaner there, and I'm going to try and melt the adhesive off from behind that paper. I'll give the paper a soaking in water first, see if that comes off. The basket is long gone. The basket just fell to pieces last year. If you've been following the bike and following the weekly big shop trips I was taking with the trailer on, you'll remember that this basket on the front was getting worse and worse every time I went to the shops. So I'll put the light back on there. It's an LED light, so that's fine. Obviously pop a saddle on it. Roadworthiness, it's not bad at all. The chain, can we see the chain? Any chance of this camera getting in to see the chain? Let's have a look. Are you able to see that? It's not really in focus, is it? There we are. You can see, not a bad chain. It certainly runs nicely. There we are. Yeah, it runs nicely inside there. There should be a black plastic piece in here and here to enclose that chain case, and I have both the pieces from another chain case, from a spare one, so I shall reinstate those. I might just spray them silver instead of black. These black plastic things, I might spray them silver instead of black. This is a trim which covers a joint that's pretty much like that one, just to tidy the joint up. They put this black plastic, this silvery plastic trim on that's faded to that gold. So I'll pop that off and give that a respray as well. Various security markings that are not factory, but they're often added by owners or corporate owners, universities, whatever. It's been left not in top gear, so yeah, it needs a service. I think we're going to have I'd rather have a new toggle chain in there, I think, just because it looks a mess. Yeah, so you can see everywhere like this, for example, that a stainless bolt hasn't been used. As rusted where there are stainless ones, it hasn't. So I just want to go through everything really. I might take that rear carrier off, because we've also got a knackered reflector on here that's full of water, and I I've put a spanner on here and nothing's happening. It's just breaking the plastic up inside and turning. So if I take the rack off, I can just zip that off with the angle grinder. Tires are okay for the moment. They're not that old. And that rear light has always been held on by a belt that's too long, that can be zipped off. So I think the frame lock, which was borrowed for the winter beater, so that needs to be put back on here. So it's pretty straightforward stuff. It just needs some care, really. An old pump peg on there that I've never used. The side stand. I'm going to look and see if the plate that mounts to is one of the short Dutch type, or if it's a universal fitting. If it's a universal fitting, I'll probably put a double leg kickstand on there, I think. Particularly because this one tows the trailer a lot. So when it's stood like this, it's often being loaded with heavy shopping and having the trailer loaded on the back of it. So a double leg kickstand is great for that. And a bung for here off one of my spare chain cases as well. And that will just about do it. The cables, both brake cables seem okay. I've had a look at those. I've had a tweak at the brakes. And just a chrome cleanup. On the front, to replace the basket, I have this. A matching brown cargo box. Ubiquitous Dutch thing. Seems to be particularly an Amsterdam thing. Is to have the plastic box on the front of the bike rather than baskets. Durability, practicality. So this can sit on the old hoop. Now these hoops I don't like for a basket because of this. They're flat steel, so they haven't got any bracing. It's no good just putting a basket on there and then hooping it onto the handlebars, which is the traditional way of doing it. You need some sort of bracketry onto the steering head. And here, the old lamp bracket has been opened out. I have the basket mounted on there on the plate. So I will drill a couple of holes. That will hold that onto there and stop any lateral movement that way, which when this bracket is bolted onto the bottom, we'll brace everything up. So the box will sit like that on the front of the bike. Aesthetics out of the window, apart from the colour matching. I did actually look for a brown one. Not gone that far with the aesthetics. And I will actually clean it as well. Other than that, pure practicality. Not as big as I would have liked to have put on. Not as big as the one on my Black Gazelle, but it'll do nicely. Right, I've cleaned the box and I'll use that for my wet and dry sanding. Doused the bike. Starting to give some of this paper softened up as well. So this was an old Bike Karma podcast sticker which I put on thinking it was waterproof, and it wasn't. I've just reminded myself, I think I'm going to change these levers. These are the old hooded rally levers that I put on, so they don't belong on this bike, they belong on rallies. And they're not as comfortable as I would like for a daily, so I'm going to put something more comfortable on there. And ditto the grips, they look nice, the cream. But I have some brown leather ergo ones I'm going to put on. They're cheap. In fact, I think they're faux, or very, very cheap leather at that. So I'm going to pop those on, because they don't matter so much as the posh leather ones, which I wouldn't want to leave outside. Right, on we crack. The kitchen scourer took care of the last of that. And now I'll give it a wipe with the brake cleaner, in order to dissolve the old Sharpie slogan that was on there. Laissez les bons temps rouler. Let the good times roll. Singularly appropriate for for our kind of cycling. Also unofficial motto of New Orleans, which is a place that I rather like. And it was just written on there a long time ago in felt tip pen, and it looked crap, so it had the sticker put on over the top of it. And it's gone. Right, now we have some 1500 wet and dry in here. Been soaking nicely for a little while. Tear it into pieces and get some serious sanding done. This rough patch of touch up here might require something a bit more than 1500. Hello, Tigger. Hello, Tigger. You're ignoring me now, I've got the camera. Yep, he always does. All I'm doing here is very lightly sanding it with the lubricated very fine paper. I'm just taking off the top layer of degraded oxidized paint, and as I go I'm feeling with my fingertips for any blebs or blemishes or scratches or scrapes or rust bubbles. And because I'm not going to spray it, I'm not going to respray the bike, I'm just leaving it at that. Any further and I'm going to start going through to primer, and I don't want that because I don't want to respray. Preparatory to a respray, it's great, you can just whack away with this. Oh, there's Shadow now. Hello, Shadow. Shadow.
Hello.
Sniffing the air, seeing what's going on. We'll probably get some catitude out here shortly as well. There he is. Hello. He's the most enormous greyhound that anyone that we'll bump into who knows greyhounds and has or had greyhounds, they'll say the same thing. He's the biggest one I've ever seen. He's absolutely enormous. Now this patch of rough here, it's coming down quite well actually. It's only domestic gloss, so it's not hard paint. Rough crinkly bits on the edges that I'm just giving a bit of extra sun power to, but I'm bearing in mind that it was put on there for a reason. There was a bare patch underneath, so I don't want to be going too much over. I'm using the phone upside down, so the camera is at the opposite corner to what I'm used to it being. Now just put down here, so I'm having to keep an extra eye on the screen. It's not good when you're doing something very visual. To answer your next question, no, I'm not taking the remains of the Romaine badge off. It's a shame there isn't a Sparta badge up here, but there isn't a one around. The Romaine badge, just going carefully. A lot of this original paint is pretty thin. There is red primer showing through. You can see clearly that it was red upside primered before it was painted. And quite a bit of it showing through. Don't have to be thorough. This isn't really a sanding down. This is a sanding off of the surface crud. It's like a tea cut, but more severe. So that'll do, that'll do. Don't want to be going too far with it. Oh my god. Swap hands. Swap you over so I can get that hand down the back of there. Ah, oh dear. I should have just gone and got the tripod out, shouldn't I? This is all the stuff that he's doing from the other side. There we are. I'll finish that off more thoroughly, rather than you have to sit through the whole shit show. and another place there where I think panniers have worn through the paint. This is making me more inclined to give the whole bike a clear coat. I like the fact that it's original paint. I like the fact that it's a survivor in that sense. And it's not supposed to be a pretty gritty bike, but I think for the sake of preservation, I might give it a clear coat. The next thing I'll be doing when I dry this off is T-cut. I'm not going to sand the plastic, obviously, but I will T-cut the plastic. Same with the box, actually. I'll T-cut the box as well, just to buff it. I won't put any polish on here until I've had a proper look at the paint and see if it's just too thin. I think it's just too thin, and I think it's going to need a clear coat, which might make the bike look a bit glossy and tacky compared to how I wanted it to look. But I've said several times it's not about looks today. I maybe should stop thinking about what it looks like and think about what's best. Careful of the stickers. Right, turn the bike around to do that other side that I couldn't get to before. Now then, we have a worryingly tiny amount of T-cut left, but that's the result after a quick T-cutting. You can still see the edges here where some of the sanding that I've just done is visible. That's what a T-cutting brings it up to. Now if I was to buff that, polish it, I could get a quite acceptable finish for a beta bike. However, the paint is really thin. So I don't regret sanding the top layer off, because I couldn't have done anything on top of that anyway. It's just a very thin layer of paint. That's red primer showing through there. So the rest of the bike has been sanded, as you can see, and now needs T-cutting. That's the finish that's left by the 1500 wet and dry. And then it will need to be thoroughly dry, probably overnight, before I think about putting any clear coat on. But clear coat is what I'm going to do. So I shall do the other jobs on it. Change that rear light, for instance. The reflector, for something that works and looks acceptable. Have a look at fitting the double leg kickstand. Thank you. Filling in the open pieces on the chain case, and then and the brake levers and grips. So there's plenty to get on with while the bike dries thoroughly. Before I put the box on, I'll give it a clear coat. Right, let's get on. Some love, and I will spray the pieces that go in here as well. Hi Jackson. Hello. Jackson's also a kitten, but he's huge because he's allegedly at least half Maine Coon. You see the tufts on the ears, but the ears aren't maybe as large as I'd expect. He's a beautiful big boy, and he's settling into his new home, along with his brother Finley, the ginger and white one, which I posted a little 2-minute video of the other day. I know this is a bike channel, but I also know that many of you are cat people. I'm a dog person and a cat person. Right, we are now officially being halted, albeit temporarily, so he gets bored. So I'm just doing the chrome. I'm not going to be taking everything to pieces and masking everything off when I clear coat, because I'm a lazy slob. So the clear coat will be overspraying onto the chrome parts, so obviously need to get the rust off those first. Even parts like the headset races, they can look disgusting if they're left. And once you get the clear coat over, that seals the rust in and you're stuck with it. All I've used is just your classic solvable auto sol, chrome polish, and just a cloth. Nothing more abrasive than that. Again, it's functionality really, striking the balance between having it looking pretty decent and presentable and it being a utilitarian bike. I'm not a fan of painted chrome, but I will just silver paint inside some of these bits, as much for protection as for anything else. I've got the rack off, as you can see, so I'll deal with that rear reflector. I've got the centre parts off the chain guard, so with the bike nicely dry, it's probably time to have a little spray. From my spare stash, some more chain case pieces. These are the two missing items that run along that gap. These two are in rather good condition. I'm tempted to just leave them black and original and pop them in. These parts here, I'll just give a little juice. This is car wheel silver, so it's tough stuff. Just come out with a tin with some rapidity, hence my little squirts. Basic of backyard bicycle restoration now. Well, you've got a bike with a white tail. Bikes that already have a white tail, that is. Giving said white tail a little coat makes such a difference. There we are. So, I ran out, didn't I? Three dead tins there. I ran out of clear lacquer. I said we were indulging in some basic backyard bike bodgery. It included using up the last bits of three tins of paint. You can see there, now it's got some lacquer on, you can actually see how much of the red primer was showing through. So I might put some kind of protector on there. I have some brown leather that's a little bit stretchy that I've used on the other bikes, so I might put something like that on it. But is that getting a little bit poncy? Probably. But unfortunately I ran out when I reached this mudguard, but at least being an exposed bit like that, I can get some more spray and just zhuzh it in. This still needs buffing up with T-cut, as does the plastic box. I might give the whole thing a T-cut afterwards, just to take the shininess down a little bit. It'll be looking a little bit shiny. It's very brown, isn't it? It is really brown. Oh, Jackson. Jackson. I think you've got some white paint in your fur. Have you been under that back mud guard? Oh no. He's about to discover the workshop. In he goes. Well, we're not going to get any rodent infestations anyway. As long as they're patrolling. Right. I did paint these bits silver in the end. But I've come to realise when I put these back in that they do more than just stop the weather getting in. They actually hold everything much more rigid. So I'm sure the chain case will now need readjustment. When I give it a road test, it'll probably go when I try and pedal, but at least once I get it adjusted, it'll stay there. And it's now weatherproof, and that I don't have a bung for at all. So I might just put a little sticker over it. That's obviously an oiling hole for the chain, rather nifty. Now it's time to stop fiddling down here. The teacup did a decent job though, you can see my reflection in it. No, you can't go in the workshop either. Right, that's the box attached. Just use some penny washers onto that floppy bracket underneath and the opened out lamp bracket, and now I can carry the bike around by it. And I've dug out a nice smart rear lamp and fitted it to the carrier, so now we've got proper lampiness instead of just reflectology, and that can go back on the bike. I'll smear a bit of either silicone or grease in that little gap there. Don't like that gap there. And there we are. That's on. Now, having won the Golden Sleep Mask Award for the most boring channel on YouTube, 5 years in succession, I thought it's about time I gave someone else a crack at the whip, so I decided not to show you all the bolting together of everything. But we'll just cut to the chase when things are fitted. I have found one mechanical issue. Loose back plate. So that's the cones, that's the bearing inside here. Needs adjusting. This is exceedingly rusty. The nut will let me get it off. Well, the loose back plate was just a matter of adjusting the bearings. I did drop the wheel out and gave it a look over. So I'm just putting the wheel back in now. Putting the brake reaction arm back onto the fork. You see the fork has a bracket on the other fork leg down here. For the brake reaction arm that came with the bike, which was a Sturmey Archer or a Sachs. And this is a Gazelle brake, which works on the opposite side. That's just my fault for putting a Gazelle wheel in. And the kickstand. See, we now have the Plesha double leg kickstand. Plesha SG, whoever made this particular one, depending on its age. It escalated slightly. I had to drill out the hole in the plate, it wasn't big enough, and I had to modify the other side of this plate to get it around the mounting for the chain case, which got in the way. So there's a bit of drilling and grinding involved. But we're on now. We've got a very sturdy kickstand now. So I just need to attend to these bits on the handlebars now. Lamp, bell, levers, grips, connect the cables up, and that should be us in business. Oh, as evening descends, over the garden. Finally, it's done. As always, it took a lot more than I thought. After the faffing on to get the kickstand to fit, which now works, although it's on this gravel, it's marginal, it needs a level surface. I decided to replace the front brake cable, didn't have a correct one because this is a Gazelle hub in a bike designed for Sturmey Archer. I had Sturmey Archer cables, but they're different, and so I made one up, and then there was a bit more faff with finding some decent levers. Well, I had lots of levers, finding some levers that were compatible with the rear cable, which is a one piece made up one, and the grips, some nice old cork ones. You can see they're not going to last an awful long time because that one's starting to split. They were on an old tandem that had their cork, but they've been shellacked umpteen times over the years, so hopefully they'll last a little while, at least through the summer. Already I've realised that that particular sticker is not waterproof. Already. So find another waterproof sticker to put on there. Shout out to Seppo at Seaside Garage in Denmark with his interesting projects. If you're into old mopeds, that's a good channel to follow. He's got some interesting old mopeds that he works on. Anyway, back to this bike. Yeah, we've got the LED light now, of course. Polished up the Chinese ding-dong bell. And one thing that's still to do, isn't there always one more thing? That's what I say about my life. There's always one more thing. This time it's the lock, and I got the lock ready to go on and realised how rusty it was, so I've given that a bit of a refurb, and the paint's drying at the moment. So tomorrow the lock can pop on before I put it out in its front parking place. And there's the rather meaty industrial looking fitment for the kickstand. As I mentioned, I've run out of clear coat before finishing the front mud guard, so when I get some more clear coat I'll do that. Yes, there is a dynamo sitting on here, not wired up at the moment, and it operates the rear mud guard light, so I'll put an LED into that. If I put a bulb in, it'll just blow when you run a rear light on its own from a dynamo. LEDs are okay, they've got the circuitry if you use the correct one. Everything generally cleaned up. More to the point, everything's serviced and adjusted. A modern gel comfort saddle on there with this old vinyl cover that was made by Raven years ago. And of course my brown and cream chloraced panniers. Shout out to the Slow Bicycle Movement. And Copenhagen Cycle Chic. Neither of those stickers are available anymore, unfortunately. Nor is that particular one from Society of Three Speeds. That's probably most appropriate for me. So as I collapse into the old gardening chair that was behind them. Yeah, that's where we are with the summer beater. I started it, the beginning of this video wasn't today, it was a while ago. I started it and it just didn't get finished. I think I mentioned it in a video earlier this week, that I had segments of this video lined up, was waiting to finish the bike. It was that old thing of getting around to it. And as predicted, it has turned out a little bit too smart for a beta. It certainly doesn't look like a beta when you start looking at the stuff that's on it. But then, you know, I've seen betas that look like they're in an advanced state of decrepitude, and then when you look, they've got all high-end equipment all over them, disguised. And that's another way to do beta bikes. They tend to be people who've got a fast commute and a long commute, and they want a high-quality bike, but obviously not appealing to thieves. And that's another way of doing beta. Some people do it that way and take a kind of a pride in the decrepit appearance of the bike. That tends to be it's popular among the bike activist community to have a nice bike that's deliberately dressed down. But then that's not my concept of beta. My concept of beta is a bike that you can just use. It's an everyday use bike that you can ride and forget. It lives outside and you just jump on, jump off. It's got everything incorporated. It's got the lock, it's got the lights. Hello, Shadow. Hello, Shadow. It's got lock, lights, comfy riding position, comfy saddle. And one of the most important things on a beta bike is luggage capacity, which this bike has in abundance. What are you doing, Shadow? Hello. So that's it, a tinkering video. Haven't had one for a while. Wasn't a very good tinkering video. Wasn't very high quality tinkering. Nothing really to show you other than me messing about. But it was nice to get some tinkering time today. I haven't had much. I think we'll have a ride in the next day or two. Go somewhere else, on something else, now that we are in high summer. And so, I'll see you shortly. And one thing I forgot to mention, yeah, I did put some leather on here. It's just sticking at the moment, and then I'll snip these zip ties off. So that's just to protect from the feet going over and avoid taking more paint off, and offering a little bit of protection for what's underneath, which has been covered in many layers of clear coat. So there we are. Take a couple of glam shots, shall we? And here is the end result. It's the next morning. The glue on the little leather protector dried. I found the saddle cover for it. Put the panniers on. And as it happens, I'm off down to Aldi for a couple of bits and pieces. So how's it turned out? Well, it rides beautifully, but it always did. The new front brake cable is feeling a tad stiff, so I need to check it to make sure I haven't caused any pinching or catching anywhere. Make sure everything's running freely. It just doesn't seem to have the power it used to have. Or maybe I'm over remembering the power, I don't know. I'll check it out anyway. And apart from that, it runs beautifully, like a Swiss watch, like a sewing machine. This bike always does. And I've forgotten how nice the ride was. The ride feels even nicer now with those nice grips. Now you can see them in proper daylight. You can see how much shellac there is on there covering the cork, so I wouldn't recommend leaving cork grips outside. But these have lived outside before on the tandem. They've got loads of shellac on there. And the saddle, I think I mentioned, was just some generic comfort saddle, in quotations. Just a cheap thing. It's probably some leftover stock from my shop, if this year's been on, because it is new. Panniers, of course, are my favourite old Clarice covers. And we've now got a rear light down here where there used to be a reflector, so that'll be good when the nights come. That's reflective tape on the back of there as well, so that overtaking vehicles get an extra flash of red, some extra rear illumination. The box is not as big as I would have liked, but it's the only brown one that I had, and that's of sort of industrial quality rather than just the thinner ones. The dynamo, as I've mentioned, is staying on there, not wired up, but I have the option of popping a dynamo light on there as well, should I keep this going through the winter. I might. I feel like I've given this bike what it deserves now. When I first got it from Mike, I pressed it straight into service as a beta, and eventually I had these cream tyres left over from something, so I put them on. I thought, oh, that looks nice. So I put some cream handlebar grips on and things like that, and just did the basket as well, which isn't really a beta thing, a wicker basket. And I started appreciating the bike. And then when I needed a beta to leave at the station when I was going back and forth to the shop, I thought of this one and started using it as that. And it remained a beta because I didn't want to restore it, I didn't want to repaint it. So it was in good condition when I got it, except that both the wheel rims had rusted through in one place. It had been stored on a damp floor with flat tyres, would be my guess. And then the cloth rim tape inside wicks up the water and rots out the rims from the inside out. That's usually what happens. So both the rims were busted, so I put these spare gazelle wheels in. It always did have drum brakes. I think one of those wheels, at least, maybe both of them now re-rimmed, are in the grey winter beater. And I have some ideas for those wheels. As I was getting these parts for the chain case yesterday, I came across the chain case of another bike that I have in pieces. It's something not dissimilar to this, but it's Dutch. Well, this is Dutch. I mean, it's a traditional Dutch double parallel, sort of double loop frame, rather than this unusual construction. I think it's by Batavus. It's just called the Amsterdam, and it's got it's purple, metallic purple, with Amsterdam in gold script and a bit of gold lining. I had a little check through, and I do have everything for it. So, apart from a set of wheels. If I take those wheels out of the redundant winter beater, I might just pop that together and have another step through on the road. That's the double leg kickstand. That's the one disadvantage of a double leg kickstand. If you've got the weight on the rear, it lifts the front wheel off the ground and lets it flop around. So the answer is load your front basket first. Right, now I'm off to get these bits and pieces and enjoy the first ride on my refurbished Romaine.